Welcome to Life Church Birmingham this morning. Please stand up and worship with us. Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? Oh, I see lightning, I hear thunder. Something stirring 6 feet under. But dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection. Oh, I see signs and I see wonder. And I see bursts of living color. Dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection.
Come alive, wake up sleeper, he is risen, and we are risen with him.
Oh, hallelujah, it is finished. See the grave, nobody.
What I see.
God of praise makes the mountains move. We'll sing from sunset till sunrise, and if worship turns our hearts to you, we'll sing from morning till midnight. Yes, we will. Yeah, we'll sing from morning till midnight. Sing all day, sing all night. Our hearts lifted up arms are open wide. God, we know what you can do when we lift up our voices to worship you.
Sing all day,
sing all night. Our hearts lifted up arms are open. Singing walls start shaking, we shout and darkness runs away. Who then can stand against the power of Jesus' name?
Come on, sing that again.
We sing and walls start shaking, we shout and darkness runs away. Who then stand against the power of Jesus' name. We sing in chains are falling. We shout 'cause there is an empty grave. We sing 'cause we believe there's power of Jesus' name. All day, sing all night. Our hearts lifted up, arms are open wide. God, we know what you can do when we lift up our voices to worship you. Sing all day, sing all night. Our hearts lifted up, arms are open wide. God, we know what you can do when we lift up our voices and worship you. Raise up and prison doors. Swing open wide. Swing open wide. Swing open our praise open prison doors. Swing open wide. Swing open wide. Swing open our praise open prison doors.
Worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You're worthy today, Father. We just declare that you are so good. Come on, can you just tell him this morning how good he is? God, you are so good. We just declare that this morning. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy today. Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. The promises you've kept and every need you've met. Lord, I'm so grateful you were with me every step, and I never will forget. 'Cause when I think of how you blessed me, how your hand has never let me go. Never let me go. Sing this with me. the blood that washed me clean, for the wrongs that you've redeemed. I know you're able. My eyes don't have to see one more reason to believe. 'Cause when I think of how you blessed me, how your hand has never let me go, never let me go. Come on, sing it out. You have been so
thank you. it out.
God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
I love him so.
I love him so. I love him so. I love him so. He's so good to me.
Come on, say God answers prayer.
Someone as you're seated this morning. If you're watching online, we want to say welcome to you online. We're so glad that you have joined us, whether you're watching on Facebook or whether you're watching on YouTube. It's good to have you. As you're being seated, if you'll look in that seat back in front of you, you'll notice a connection card like this. Every week we take a moment and we fill out these connection cards so we can connect with one another. And there's a couple of things on the back that I want to draw your attention to this morning. Can we just take a moment and welcome all of our first-time guests, whether they're watching online or whether they're in the room with us. We just want to say welcome. We're so glad that you're here. If you're a first, second, or third-time guest, there's a place for you to mark that on our connection card. We want to put a face with a name. We want to connect with you, and we have a special gift for you right after service, right out in the foyer at our connections table. We'd love to meet you and just see how we can connect with you, how we can serve you. Also, you'll notice on the back of the connection card there is a place for prayer requests. We believe in the power of prayer and praying with one another and for one another. And then you'll notice that there's a place that you can mark whether you would like those prayer requests to be confidential, or whether you want those shared with the prayer team. So if there's anything going on in your life that we can pray with you about, that we can join in prayer with you about, if you'd like our pastoral staff to pray with you, just mark confidential. Or if you want to open that up and for us to send that out to our prayer team for them to be praying with you about that this week, you can mark that on the back as well. One other thing you'll notice on the back of the connection card to mark, there's a place that says, sign me up for the missions banquet on February 3rd. And so on February 3rd, Saturday night, we're going to have a missions banquet here, and we're going to have our special missionary from Tanzania. You don't want to miss Jeff Garrett as he comes and shares. It's going to be a special, kind of a little bit more intimate time. We'll have a meal together, and he's going to share some stories about what God is doing around the planet, what God is doing in other places in the world that you and I may never go to people that we may never speak the same language as, to places that we maybe can only see on Google Maps. And so you don't want to miss the stories that he's going to share. You don't want to miss this opportunity to hear what God is doing around the world, to be stirred in the area of mission, stirred in your faith, and enjoy a good meal all at the same time together. So if you want to be a part of that, we've got about 100 spaces available for that. So you can make that, you can mark that on the back of your connection card. There's also a QR code that you can scan. You can also go on our Facebook page. You'll see that advertisement on our Facebook page, as well as the Life Church Birmingham app, and you can get registered there. There's no cost. It's a free event, but we just want you to be with us. We want you to join together with us and participate in this great missions banquet. Well, this morning, Pastor Tim is going to come, and he's going to break the bread of life with us and share the word of God. Would you just give it up this morning as Pastor Tim comes and shares the word of God?
Thank you, Pastor John. Someone asked, can I bring my kids? And the answer is yes, please. We want them to be part of that for Saturday night for our missions banquet. It's going to be a good time, and you don't want to miss it. It'll be right in here, right in here. Well, I'm glad you're here. Grab your Bibles and turn to Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel chapter 37. Someone once said, the sermon is the preacher up to date. The sermon is the preacher up to date. I want to let you know where I am and just kind of the angle which I'm speaking to you this morning. Many of you know that we're in a season of prayer and fasting, and we're humbling ourselves before the Lord. We're asking for His provision, we're creating space and asking God to fill it. And so as I come to you today, three things paint the lens of the message. First of all, I'm coming to you as a humble man. The longer I live, the more I realize I don't know. there's things I don't know. And the longer I live, the more I realize there's things that are completely out of my control. I have zero control over so many things. And I'm coming to you as a humble pastor. And I pray that is genuine, and I don't just say that. but I am humble before you. Second thing, I come to you as a desperate man, a desperate pastor. I'm desperate for the Lord. I realize unless he breathes his breath, nothing's coming to life. Unless the breath of life comes, I'm sunk in the water. I'm desperate because, again, I have no control over so many things, but he is able. He is able. And the third thing, I come to you, I'm grateful. I'm grateful. I'm grateful for what he's done for me. I'm grateful to be here as the pastor. I'm grateful for my family. I'm grateful for the season that he's placed us in. I'm grateful. I'm grateful for all the good things that he has done. I'm grateful for the gifts of God, and some of them he has shared with me, and some of them I am stretching towards. I am grateful, and so I come to you as humble and desperate and grateful, and invite you in for the last week of prayer and fasting. If you don't know what that's about, grab a book on the way out, a booklet at the registration table, and just join in with us. And let me just say this to you, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. I want to read something to you before we read out of Ezekiel 37. That's our theme scripture for the year. Our theme this year is deeper. Come on, how many want to go deeper? How many want to go deeper? And so Jeremiah 29, we read this last week, and here's what it says. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with what? All of your heart. All of your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the places, from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. And we see that God had allowed the Babylonians to come and ravage Jerusalem. They had destroyed the temple, destroyed the walls, taken people captive about 500 miles into Babylon. Babylon was just about 50 miles south of Baghdad. And they'd gone to Jerusalem and taken these captives. And that's where you see Jeremiah and Ezekiel writing about that. They're writing about that. This is a call to go deeper. It's a call to go deeper. The promise, I will bring you back from captivity, is a conditional promise. That will happen when you will seek me and find me with all of your heart. The Bible says, I will be found by you, declares the Lord. And this morning, if you're a little bit desperate, what I would say to you is you're in a good place for a miracle this morning. Come on. Jesus is calling us out to the deep. He's calling us out to the deep, away from the security and the comfort of the shoreline, to come out to deeper places. Ezekiel 37 writes, at about the same time Jeremiah writes. Ezekiel 37, God gives the prophet a vision, and here's the story. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, son of man, can these bones live? I said, Sovereign Lord, you're the only one that knows. You alone know. Then he said to me, okay, prophesy. Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I'll put my breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesy as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise. There's a noise, a rattling sound. The bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breath from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded. And breath entered them, and they came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Let's pray. Lord, we need you. We need you. We look around, and we can identify somewhat with Ezekiel. And we look around, and we see dry bones. They're around us during our life. Maybe we're facing situations which it's just dust and dry and no life. Lord, unless you breathe the breath of life, those dead places will stay dead. But you are able. You are able. And so, God, with everything, with all the authority and the anointing that you have shared with me and allowed me to have, breath of life, come and breathe on us this morning. In the name of Jesus, amen. So what do you do? There's a valley full of bones. I want to give you three takeaways that take this unusual, can we say that? Unusual scripture and bring some practicality to it as we unpack it. The first thing is this. I'll follow God and see with new vision. I'll follow God and I'll see with new vision. God is the one that gives us vision to see. God leads me to places. The Bible says, Ezekiel records, the hand of the Lord was upon me and brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord. That's prophetic talk for he's having a vision. It's a vision from the Lord. God is giving him a vision. Ezekiel was a prophet. He was a prophet like Jeremiah. Ezekiel and Jeremiah, as we said before, were written about the same time. The Israelites were in Babylonian exile. The Babylonians had attacked Israel, destroyed Jerusalem, its walls, its temple, and taken them away. They were in an unfamiliar area, unfamiliar place, with unfamiliar circumstances, and it felt very hard and difficult. 500 miles away in captivity. Jeremiah had already spoken to the people that were in exile. He had already spoken to all the Israelites. He had prophesied and said, look, some are saying, you're getting out of here soon. I'm telling you, that's not the case. You will be here for a while. He gives 70 years as a number. So go ahead and build a house. Go ahead and plant a garden. Go ahead and find wives for your kids. Have children. Eat from the garden. Get connected to where you are. In other words, don't be so homesick that you disconnect from the opportunity that you have been given, even when it's difficult. He had a vision. That's about what we know. I've been praying this week that God would increase visions and dreams. Acts tells us, Acts 2, 17, when the Holy Spirit was poured out and Peter stands up to preach and explain what's going on, the prophecy fulfilled says, I'll pour out my spirit in the last days. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Come on, your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. I'm praying for that. I'm praying for increased vision to see, increased dreams. I probably had three, maybe four dreams in my life that I would attribute as a dream from the Lord. I want more dreams from God. I want to see better things, more things. I want increased vision. Ezekiel's in the middle of a valley, and the valley was full of bones. The Bible says he was led among them. The language is he got in and among them, very close, back and forth, back and forth. God wanted him to get an accurate view of what was happening, not from afar. He wanted him up close. And he noticed they were laid out on the floor of the valley. These bones, we later learn in the passage, were bones of people. Not animals, they were people. And they had been left without a proper burial. To the elements, to the scavengers. And like our culture, their culture too, would feel that was a disgraceful thing. It hadn't been attended to. That's what the women went to do on Resurrection Day for Jesus' body. That's what they thought they were going to do, because they had to hurry and put him in a grave because Sabbath was beginning and they couldn't do anything on Sabbath. So as the sun comes up, they're headed to give a proper burial with spices and tend to his body. These bones had not had that. And Ezekiel was aware. There's lots of bones. No life. They're sun bleached, dusty. The point is, they'd been there for a while. In other words, there's no misunderstanding. This thing is dead. It's dead. The life that was once there is gone. Do you know someone like that? Do you have a situation in your life that's like that? You say, man, there ain't a pulse. Not only is there not a pulse, it's just dusty, dry bones. You can't, every once in a while, you know, we'll hear about someone that they thought was gone and they wake up later, like with a faint heartbeat. We hear about those things once in a while. There's no misunderstanding this one. There's no way for that to happen. It's dusty and dead and gone. In Ezekiel, God wants to know what Ezekiel thinks. Is there any hope? When he says, can they live again? Another way to say that is there any hope here? Is there a chance of a miracle? Is there a chance in your dead situation of a miracle? What do you believe, Ezekiel? Is there a remote, even a remote possibility of a reversal of this thing? Can it come back? Not how you want it to be, but how God wants it to be. Is there any hope there? I mean, Ezekiel didn't even have marrow to deal with. The bones were dried up and gone. Can these bones come back to life? Can they live again? There used to be life and potential and purpose and meaning and joy and worship. All that. Is there any hope here, Ezekiel? Ezekiel, where's your faith? That's what he's asking him. I want to ask you, where's your faith? Hebrews 11:6 says this, without faith, what's it say? It's impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and he rewards those who earnestly seek him. For the gifts of the Spirit to flow in and through us, for God to use us, there has to be two things present for God to use you. An operative God, and as theologians call it, a cooperative human agent. That's fancy talk for God and you. An operative God, God, are you able, cooperative human agent, what do you think about this situation? Is there any hope? God, can you use me in this situation? So God draws a line in the sand. You ever had a line drawn in the sand in your situation? You're like, all right, that's where I can't do nothing past this line. It's out of my hands. I wish I could jump over the line and take care of it, but I can't. It's not because I don't want to. Oh, the Lord knows I want to. It's about I can't do. I don't have the ability to. There's nothing I could offer on the other side of the line. What I need right here on this line is for the natural to meet the supernatural. I need an intervention. Can these bones live again? Can these bones live again? God drew a line in the sand. It's about 16 years ago. We were experiencing a revival in youth ministry at a former church that I had really not been part of as far as the numerical growth before. I had not seen that before in our ministry. And we had, there was a lot cooking. We had Tuesday night stuff, Wednesday night stuff. And so the Lord began to send, the enemy began to come in and try to distract. And so these middle schoolers were getting arguments at school, and then they would say, I'll meet you at church tonight, we're going to fight. What? Right across from the street was a big city park. And so they would do as I said. It got to the point where we were in contact with the school counselors and leadership and the police. We had the non-emergency numbers. We knew some of their names. All right, who's fighting tonight? And it got, let me tell you what, I kind of chuckle, but it ain't really funny it's not that humorous. And so, one night, the kind of the straw on the camel's back, so to speak, as these two kids got into it, and I just want to tell you what happened. I was mortified. We didn't know it was coming. We couldn't get our hands on it. And we had a couple big fellas outside working in the skate park. When I say big fellas, I mean big fellas. And these kids started scrapping, fell into the doorway of the lobby and rolled into the door into the lobby of the church fighting while women my grandmother's age are trying to come into Wednesday Bible study, and these 15-year-olds are punching each other in the face. And I'm, oh God, I am so fired. Oh my God, this is horrible. So finally one night, I'm like, listen, we got to get the police down here. They just need to be here. And so I called, and they showed up, and there had been this thing, and these guys rolled up, and they got their stick, whatever, stun gun, and tear gas, and this badges, And so I'm like, man, I'm glad you guys are here. We need some help. And that police officer walked to me like this. Justin, you ever do that? Just walk up like you don't. He says, what are you going to do about this? I was so shocked. I'm like, call you? That's what my plan is, call you? I was hoping you might have some answers about that. I'll never forget that statement. When you expect somebody else to come into your situation and be the catalyst that God uses to change it, and don't come to the table with at least a little bit of faith or something to say, God, you alone know. You alone know. So I told that story the last sermon I preached there. I wasn't fired. I got out of there relatively unscathed and came here. And this retired police officer gave me this bullet. It's a .45 caliber. What I said in the story is this dude rolled up with his 9mm stick, his stun gun, all this stuff. I was hoping he'd bring some water. He came up to me and said, Jacksonville PO doesn't carry 9, they carry 45s. And he gave me this bullet. He deactivated it. Supposedly, if you guys want to try it out with a hammer later and see if it's got any gunpowder. But I keep this on my desk. Why do I keep this on my desk? I keep this on this desk to remind me that God wants to know, what are we going to do about it? God wants to know where your faith is. God wants to know, listen, what do I have to work with? In that's the same season the Babylonians had taken Daniel, you know, in the lion's den, by the way. He was an old man by the time he made it to the den. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're all there, right? Now, you might not know this, but Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego was not their name their mama gave them. That was their Babylonian name. They'd come to Babylon, and Babylon says, look, I want to change your name, your identity, what you think about, what you look like, what you eat. I want you to look like us, sound like us, act like us, think like us. I want you to talk like you're a Babylonian. And God says, listen, consecrate yourself. Be a holy people. Don't conform to the pattern of the world, but be holy. Where your power stops, the supernatural picks up. Can I say, first of all, most every time, you're capable of way more than you think you are. You're capable of way more than you think you are. And sometimes I think, I don't know, maybe it's just me, sometimes I get maybe discouraged or lazy or don't know what, and so I think that God should jump over the line and do things that I'm able to do. I don't know if anyone's ever been there, and I think sometimes God stands on the other side of the line and says, I'm just waiting for you to get a little closer, because there's a couple more things that I put inside of you that I want to pull out, but I'm over on the other side, and I'm ready to do my part. God asks Ezekiel, can they live? And Ezekiel says, only you know. Romans 4:17 says, God gives life to the dead and calls into existence those things that do not exist. Only God knows. But God wants to know what you think. God wants to use your voice in 2024. He wants to use your voice. What dead things are around you that have potential? There's no faint heartbeat there. There's not even rotting flesh. They're dusty and dry. God gives us vision to see. That's why we're fasting and praying. That's why we're setting time aside and slowing down and pushing out media and screen time. He's the great revealer. If you want to know how to deal with your dead situation, ask God. Get alone with God. God tells Ezekiel, what are you supposed to do? What we need is sensitivity. Here's an old term that you may not have heard for a while. We need to be led by the Spirit, don't we? We need to be led by the Holy Spirit. And then we've got to have the faith to follow Him. I'll follow God and see with new vision. He says to the bones. He prophesies to them. And then the second thing I want you to take away from this is this. I'll glorify God and speak His words. I'll glorify God and speak His words. So he says to Ezekiel, hey, prophesy to the bones. I just want you to picture that a moment. I just want you to pretend you can only see Ezekiel. You don't see God leading him. You don't see God directing him. You're kind of like, you know, just watching from a few feet away. And you see old Ezekiel, he's walking between the bones. He's noticing everything about him. And then all of a sudden, he begins to talk to the bones. He begins to prophesy to the bones. Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. And you're over there watching going, huh, I wonder what this is all about. Hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says. I'll make breath enter you. And you will come to life, dry bones. I'll attach tendons to you, make flesh come upon you, cover you with skin. I'll put breath in you, you'll come to life. Then you'll know that I'm the Lord. And you're watching this and you're going, wow, you know, told me Ezekiel was weird, but man, don't he know this thing is over? This battle had been lost decades ago already. The bones are there, they're dry. Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Ezekiel speaks on behalf of God. That's at the heart of New Testament prophecy. Speaking on behalf of God. I got a question. What do you think God's saying about your situation? Not what you're saying. Everybody knows what you're saying. You told us all. What does God say about your situation? We need to get an ear tuned into heaven. We need to get the word out and say, okay, God, what do you say about my situation? What do you say about what I'm going through? What do you say about this season I'm in? What do you say? And then what you do, you get a scripture in context that relates to it, right? You get it inside of you and you declare that over your situation. You hide the word in your heart. And you, hold on a minute, prophesy to dry bones. God says, I want you to speak my words over them. Say to them what I'm saying about them. A whole bunch of dry bones know they're already dry. They know it. They're dead, 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 D-E-D, dead. Some of y'all, that's the only thing you remember from this morning. They're dead. N is for knowledge. They're dead. Thank you. Thanks, buddy. Tell you what, I get hot in the summer and thirsty, but this gas heat, man, it drieth thy mouth. Thank you, sir. We are called as a church to amplify His words, to amplify His message. I don't know how, don't mean to hurt your feelings, but I don't know how powerful your personal opinion is. I'm not, hey, it might be, but I'll tell you an opinion that is much more powerful than yours. We are called to amplify the word of the Lord, to preach the gospel, the whole truth, and live it out. We can't back down because in the natural, the situation looks hopeless. Think of Ezekiel. The enemy wants to intimidate you into being quiet. The enemy wants to wear you out so you feel powerless. The enemy wants to so consume you with the condition of the bones on the floor of the valley that you never have the faith to say, listen here, dry bones, come alive. He says, bones, this is what the Lord says. Not what Ezekiel says. Not Ezekiel's opinion. He asked his opinion. Can they live? You know. You alone know. So he says, tell this to the bones. I'll make breath enter you and you'll come to life. Interesting words there. Breath. Hebrew word, same word used for the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament. The Spirit of God was hovering over the waters in creation, right? Ruach, Hebrew, same word, right? I'll cause life-giving breath to come into you. I'll make tendons attached to you. Now, when God's involved, He's in the process of rebuilding, not just putting a Band-Aid on things. You know what tendons do, right? I remember this from 10th grade anatomy. Ligaments are bone to bone. Tendons are muscle to bone because they're tender. So you learned something in school today, kids. I'll make tendons come on you. Well, wait a minute. How are tendons going to help a bunch of bones? Bones by themselves can't move. Muscle by itself can't move. It's when the tendons are attached to the muscle, the bones are attached to the muscle with the tendons that movement is possible. So God is saying, I'm going to rebuild this thing, not with a Band-Aid, but I'm going to rebuild it from the ground up. I'll make flesh come on you. All right, here comes the muscle. I'll cover you with skin. Now they got a shell. And I'll put breath in you, you'll come to life. So Ezekiel is preaching the gospel. He's telling them, he's prophesying to the dead bones. God has a word for these bones. Where there is death, God still speaks. You may have come this morning and you say, oh, Tim, you don't know how dead it is. My answer to you is, yeah, probably not. The bones were dusty. The language is sun scorched. They'd been out there for a while. They'd been in the elements for a while. They'd been forgotten about. There was no one out there to save the day. They were dead. Once the breath enters, the life comes. The transformation takes place when the Spirit of God is present in the situation. How do we make that practical? We are called to advance the kingdom of God. So we do what Ezekiel did. We get a word from the Lord. And by the way, what you need to do is look to the written word. If you want to hear what God has to say about a situation, read the Bible. If you want to hear what He has to say about a situation out loud, like you want to hear the voice of God audible, read the Bible out loud, and He'll speak to you. And so we get the word of the Lord, and we speak that to our dead place. The breath brings transformation. There's life in the breath. The problem with the bones is they had no life-giving breath in them. Tendons, muscles, ligaments. So He first puts the bones back together. They're a person. You see them. The insides are connected. There's a shell on the outside. There's skin. But there's no life yet. You can have structure, listen, and content and movement, but without the breath of God, it won't be productive. Don't spend your time in dead situations just spinning wheels. Back up, Get a word from the Lord and stand on the word. Get some people of faith around you that can speak the word of God in your situation. What is it that you need? I need reconciliation. Let's look to see what the word says about forgiveness and reconciliation. And let's speak that over ourselves. Speak that over our situation. I need healing. Let's see what the word says about healing. I need some breakthrough in my finances. Let's see what the Bible says about money. I need a miracle in my relationships. Let's see what the word says about that. And stand on the word and let it change you first. As you speak it into the situation. Once the whole thing comes together, God says, then you'll know that I'm the Lord. It's when it comes together, everyone will back up and say, man, look at that. Look at what God has done. How many have a look what God has done story? Only the Lord. Only the Lord could do that. Only the Lord could accomplish that. Only the Lord could bring that about. I ain't smart enough for that. I'm not good enough. I don't have enough talent. There ain't no way that could happen. But look what the Lord has done. I feel like singing that song. Look what the Lord has done. Then you will know that I am the Lord, he says. Ezekiel says two statements many times in his book. Look what the Lord, then you will know what the Lord, then you will know that I am the Lord. And slight variations, 65 times. How many think that's an important part of the message? 65 times, then you will know that I'm the Lord in his book. The other thing that he says numerous times is the glory of the Lord. For those of you Bible students, 19 times. Why do I mention that? When you talk about prophecy or speaking the word of God, the big picture is the revelation of God and his glory. That's like the point. That's like the point. You can distinguish between those who operate in gifts and those who operate in their own flesh or whatever. Is the big picture about the revelation, the glory of God, or is it self-aggrandizing? Then you will know that I'm the Lord, revealing God in his glory. Proverbs 18:21 says this, the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. It matters what you say. It matters what you say. There's power of life and death in the tongue, and those who love it eat its fruit. God uses your words to shape a situation. God uses your words to bring about change in his kingdom. How do people get saved? By the preaching of the word, by the foolishness of preaching the gospel. My voice, I push wind across vocal cords, it vibrates. And that vibration produces a sound. And some of you don't like my voice, some of you might, some of you love it. It produces frequencies, right? It travels through the airways to your three inner ear bones. Three, right? Three, and they vibrate, and then that connects to neurons. And those neurons go to your brain, and those vibrations are translated into noises that have meaning. And through that process, when the meaning comes, then you understand the words, and that's where faith rises up. God chooses to save people through the foolishness of preaching. That's funny to me. That's funny to me. There's power, life and death in the tongue. Hebrews 1:3 says this, the sun in his radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. In other words, Jesus sustains this whole thing by his powerful word. God speaks to the bones through Ezekiel's voice. God wants to speak to a dead generation, and he wants to use you. God wants to use you to do it. God wants to use you to speak to your dead situation, to dead generations, to dead places, dead systems, dead marriages, dead workplace, dead classrooms. Please, for the love of God, pray over your students. Dead family trees. In the natural, it's dead, dead, dead. However, in the spirit, life is possible. Glorify the Lord in your situation by speaking His words. I know a man who life-giving encouragement oozes out of him. I don't even think he does it intentional. It just has become so part of who he is. It just happens. So we were at a track meet a couple weekends ago, saw one of Macy's high school coaches. He's now moved on to a university, and so he's there, and so he sees us. Oh, how are you guys doing? We're hugging him. Good to see you, blah, blah, blah. He says to Macy, hey, what are you studying? She says, elementary ed. He says, you are going to make an amazing teacher. You are gonna be so good at that. And I looked over at and Macy's like, oh, I guess I am. I don't think Tom Esslinger even knows what he did that day. There's plenty of dead words being said over your dead situation. Would someone please rise up and speak some life where there's dead places? Speak some life. I'll glorify God and speak His words. The third thing is this. Worship team, come. So I prophesied as I was... third thing. I obey God and trust Him to do the rest. There is only so much you can do. But you can do. Everybody say, I can do. Only so much. But I can do. So I'll obey God, trust Him to do the rest. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise. Everybody say, a noise. There's a noise. A rattling sound. The bones came together, bone to bone. You could hear it. It was audible. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them. Skin covered them. But there's no breath yet. It took me about 3 hours of looking at this passage to notice something. You may have seen it right away. I mean, it's right there in front of us. I had written 38 things that I observed about this. I just looked and what is it? It was for 3 hours I saw this. Verse 7, so I prophesied as I was, commanded. Ezekiel follows the commands of the Lord. I would submit to you that God demands that we do some things. I don't know what that sounds like when it hits your ears. I prophesied as I was commanded. It didn't say he felt like it. It didn't say that he wanted to or didn't want to. Ezekiel's feelings were taken out of the equation. I did as I was commanded to do. And he obeyed God. He did as he was told. He followed the directions God had given him. He said yes to God. I prophesied as I was commanded. God didn't suggest that Ezekiel speak life over a situation. He didn't suggest that he say the word of the Lord over the bones. He didn't say, you know, Ezekiel, if you want to see some really cool stuff, here's just something to think about, Ezekiel. Would you consider this, Ezekiel? Would you, pray about this? He didn't say any of that. He said, say it. Sometimes we act like obedience is optional. Once he began to speak, stepped out, the bones started moving. There's a rattling. They start moving. You could hear some commotion. I would submit to you that when you step into dead areas and begin to speak words of life over them, when movement starts, it doesn't always make sense. It doesn't always become clear what is happening. Stand firm. Stand firm. Stand firm. Be bold and follow through. So they get to the deal. All this happens, but there's no breath in them. God began to line some things up before the life came. He began to move some situations around so that when the breath came, the situation was ready for the breath. So he says to me, verse 9, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says, come breath from the four winds, breathe into the slain that they may live. So I prophesied as he, there it is again, commanded me. And breath entered them, and they came to life and stood as a vast army. God tells Ezekiel, complete the process. Now there's bones connected, no breath in them. From the outside, everything feels like, seems like, it should be moving, but what they were missing was the invisible. You can't see breath. Some of you might argue, I saw my breath this week when it was like 12. I saw my breath. There's no breath. There's lifeless, white, dusty bones. Life is in the breath. Life is in the spirit. We need to be connected to the Spirit of God. When we sing songs, we don't just sing random songs. We're singing songs to, for, and about God. Sometimes when you sing, you are prophetic. You are speaking the word of the Lord over a situation that ain't that yet. It don't seem like there's life there yet. Speak to the dry bones. Speak the word of the Lord. Sing over them. Worship over them. Be people connected to the Spirit through worship. Men, express yourself. Let's be more expressive. Let's tap into that side of us that we reserve at times. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. We're connected to the Spirit through worship and prayer and the Word. And then we release the words of God. We release the words of God through prayer. And I would suggest to you, prophecy, that you are speaking the words of God over your situation. You are saying what God has to say about it. Oh, my son may be messed up, jacked up, drug out, strung out. But God has the last word in this situation. My marriage may be dried up, dead, dusty, but man, you know about life. There weren't life a year ago. It is dusty, dry. Speak the words of life. Isaiah 55, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty. It will accomplish what I desire to achieve, the purpose for which it was sent. Here's where we land, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, are contemporaries. God says, Jeremiah, about speaking his words. Today I give you authority over nations and kingdoms to uproot and pull down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. That is a picture of intercessory prayer and worship and activity in the kingdom. You have power. Lord said to me, Jeremiah, what do you see? I answered, a branch of an almond tree. You're right, the Lord says. Here's what I want to emphasize. I am watching to see that my words come true. God has the last say in your situation. I am watching over my words, the Lord says, to see, to ensure, to see that they come true. Mighty man of faith, rise up. Mighty woman of faith, rise up. Don't retreat. Don't be beaten back. Don't rise up. Speak to the dead situation. God, I give you my family. God, I give you this situation, my family. Lord, you're the author of life. You said that children are a blessing from the Lord. So I release them to you. Now give me wisdom as a parent. I speak life over that situation. God, you own the cattle on a thousand hillside. God, wealth comes from you. You're the source of all blessings. So God, I'm praying where there's lack, God, there would be abundance. God, I speak to the lack and I pray for abundance. Now you can't do that flat on your back in the bed and not willing to get up, turn the key and go to work, right? I pray for abundance. Now, God, help me to realize every opportunity that's in front of me. Anoint me and prepare me for what's next. God, I speak life. And then the Holy Spirit begins to wash over you. The Holy Spirit begins to change you. So when you meet the line of the natural meeting the supernatural, God says, there it is. And he meets, and life comes. Life comes. Life comes. Would you stand up on your feet? In 2024, we're going deeper. We're going deeper. We're going deeper in worship. If you want this to be powerful in your life, if you remember one thing today, be a person of worship. Be a man of worship. Be a woman of worship. Be someone that sings unto the Lord. I'm thankful for sound systems because y'all can't hear how bad I sing. I'm thankful that you can take this home. You can make up your own song, right? You can make up your own song. Get used to hearing your own voice in your prayer closet. The enemy will intimidate you because you ain't singing on key. It's you and God. Like, who cares, right? I'm thankful for CD player, or I don't know what CDs are, MP3s. I'm thankful for cassette players and 8-tracks and records. You can just play and sing. Be a person of worship. Be a person of worship. Be a person of worship. Come on, be a person of worship. Be a person of worship. Would you bow your head and close your eyes? My goal today is to help make this practical in your life so you would be empowered to make a difference. What's your dry thing? Where's the dry area? Is there a young person in the path of your life? Oh, they're dry bones. Is there a relationship around you? Maybe you're involved in that relationship and there's dry bones. Maybe you're on the outside of that and we tread lightly on that, but we speak life in that situation. Maybe there's death in your health, or maybe it's in your finances or your work and your emotions. Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Get a scripture and speak that over your situation. Speak it over your situation. Speak the name of Jesus over your situation. Say what God says about it. Say what God says about it. Say what God says about it. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here, you say, Pastor Tim, I got dry bones in my life. First thing, my spiritual life is dry bones. I have like no spiritual life. I'm dead inside, spiritually dead. I need salvation. I need repentance. I need forgiveness. I need God to bring life. I'm running from God, or I'm far away from God. I didn't mean to. I don't know how I got here, but that's where I find myself. I'm away from the Lord, and I need the breath of life. I need Jesus. I need Jesus to heal the inside of me. I need Jesus to forgive me. I need Jesus to make me whole. I need Jesus to be the Lord of my life. I've been running things my own self, and they ain't worked out real good for me. I need the Lord. I need, first things first, I got, my spirit is a valley of dry bones, and I need Jesus to save me. On the count of three, just wave at me. Pastor, pray for me. That's what I need this morning. That's what I need that. On the count of three, just wave at me. That's what I need this morning. One, two, three. All over the place. Yeah. Come on. There's more. I need the Lord. I need Him. Second thing is this. You're here today, and you've got a situation in your life, and it's dry bones. It may not be your spiritual life. It may be something on the outside. And you say, Pastor, come on, pray for me. I've when I walk among the bones, oh, they're there. They're dead. It's dead. There needs to be life. Today, I need boldness and help. I need boldness to help to speak life over my dry bone situation. If that's you on the count, just wave at me. One, two, three, all over the place. Come on, all over the place, all over the place. My hands are, I got two hands up this morning. Both my hands are up. That's what I need. That's what I need. That's what I need. Come on. Come on. I feel like the Lord just gave me a word for you. And here it is. You judge if this is from God for you. The Lord says, quit trying to figure out all the details and fix all these little things. But come to me. Seek me. And I'm going to walk you through the rest. Quit trying to figure out all the details, getting snagged and hung up on the small things. Come to me. Come to me. And I'm going to help untangle it for you. If that's for you, just begin to worship the Lord. Just begin to thank Him. 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 Begin to thank Him. If there's dry bones on the inside and you need to come to the Lord, the Bible says we're saved by the grace of God through faith in Jesus. that he's the one that paid for our sins, and he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins when we ask him. And so right now, I want to lead you in a prayer. If that's you, you need that. You need to come to Christ. I want to pray with you right now. And there are going to be people all around you that pray this with you. And if you mean it from your heart, it's as if you made it up yourself. If you believe these words, you're going to say, can I help you in praying? And I want you to do it out loud. There'll be people all around you. If there's dead inside, dead spirit, you need Jesus to heal the inside. You need Jesus to save you. You need to come to him. You need to be born again. That's you. You raise your hand or you should have. Let's pray this together right now, would you? Say, dear God, thank you for sending your son to die on the cross for my sins. And today, I ask you for help. I lay down my life and ask you to forgive me. I've sinned. I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. Jesus, I submit to you, Lord, as the Lord of my life. I believe you're the Son of God. You died and you rose from the dead. Thank you for setting me free and saving me. I love you, Jesus. Just begin to tell you love him. Come on. There's a sweet presence in here right now. There's a sweet presence in here right now. There's a sweet presence in here right now. If you have dry bones in your life, you prayed that prayer, or you raised your hand for the other, or you should have, you got dry bones, I want to encourage you to respond to the Lord, to step towards him. We're gonna declare some things and sing some things. The Lord says, let me take care of the details, just come on to me. Come on to me. If you want dry bones in your life to come alive, I invite you to respond and come to the altar and just begin to tell him. Begin to ask him. Begin to lay it down before him. You need that this morning. Just begin to come. We're going to sing in a minute. If that's you, you need that, come. And as a friend comes, I want you just to come with them. Put your hand upon their shoulder and just begin to pray with them. If you want dry bones to come alive, you want to seek him, just begin to come as they begin to sing. And as someone comes, I just want you to come and just lay your hands on them and come, encourage a friend. Come on, let's seek the Lord. Come on, together, let's sing. Come on, men, come help me. Come on, men, come help me. Come on. Come on, ladies, come help me. Come on, ladies, just come on, help me. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Begin to lift your hands right now. Sing.
Shout Jesus.
Come on.
Shout Jesus from the mountain.
He's able.
Jesus.
Come on, he's able. He's able.
He's
able.
Shout Jesus, shout Jesus, shout Jesus.
Shout Jesus.
person of worship. I know your life is a form of worship, and your work, your studying, your parenting, your wifing, husbanding, your relate, that's a form of worship. It's acts of obedience. Do that. What I'm talking about is this, what we're doing now. Be a person of worship. Be a person that becomes familiar with the Holy Spirit. You want to be led by the Spirit, you need to distinguish what is of the Holy Spirit. Be a person that does that. I feel like I have a word for one person at least. And I feel like the Lord would have me demonstrate this. Some of you, the Lord says, are walking towards me. You're walking. And I feel like the Lord says, stop walking and start running. Stop walking and start running. Stop walking and start running towards Him. Start running towards Him. Start running towards Him. Says the Lord. Run towards Him. Run towards Him. Run towards Him. Every year when we do this 21 days, there's breakthrough. God is breaking through in your situation. Don't stop now. Don't stop now. Don't stop now. Thank you, Lord. We just thank Him one more time. Lord, we just love you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We love you, God. Now, if you've responded, if God's doing something, I think each of us need to have at least one person walking through us with our situation. Don't be an island. Don't be that person. I got it. You don't got it. He made us to depend upon each other. He actually made us to be dependent upon one another. He made us so we'd be in a relationship. Have somebody to walk with you. Your dry bone situation may not be for everybody to hear about, but you need one or two people to know about it, help you. Second, I hope that you're able to make it to our missions banquet. We're going to throw the graphic up there. There's a QR code that's going to be on the screen. It's also on the posters out in the lobby and in the bathroom stalls that will lead you to a registration. You can also register through the connection card. We try to make it as easy as possible. You can scan that QR code, if you can see over Caden's head, and get to it. It'll take you to a link. Bring your kids. Bring them. There'll be dinner served. Dinner's free. We just want another opportunity for you to hear a missionary and hear what it's like through the eyes of a missionary. You're going to hear mission stories and stuff. There's room for about 100. So come on, teenagers, come on. Bring some friends with you. Bring your family. Have them come and meet a real live missionary. Hear stories about what God's doing, what the supernatural. God is exploding through Tanzania right now. I mean, absolutely exploding through Tanzania right now. And you want to hear about it. I'm telling you, you want to hear about it. Our missionary, Jeff Garrett, that we've been supporting for years, I think maybe 2 decades out of this church, will be with us that Saturday night and that Sunday morning as well, the 4th of February. Sign up, be part of that. And then this Wednesday, we're in here, adults will be in here. No more ice, no more 12 degree temperatures, hopefully, I don't know. But we'll be in here studying the book of James. Come and be part of that study. Come study the word. If you want to be an overachiever, read chapters 2 and 3 and be part of that, or just come on for that. Now, when you leave today, there's groceries available in the lobby for you, your friends, or to take to someone, or for you to use yourself. They're free, no strings attached, none of that. We just want you to have them. And if you're a guest, please stop by and drop off your connection card. We'll also, the ushers will be there to receive your tithe, their offerings. There's a tithe envelope, the seat back in front of you, and There's several ways to give as well. Thank you for your generosity. We love you. Can I pray for you? Can I pray for you? Father, I thank you that you're the Word made, or you sent the Son, the Word made flesh to dwell among us. Everything that you have for us, that you can give us this side of heaven, is in Jesus. Jesus, teach us how to be close to you so that we understand when your Spirit is speaking. Give us the boldness, the courage to speak life where there's dry bones, and take us deeper in Jesus' name. I pray blessing of your people. Bless them at school. Bless them at work. Bless them, bless them, bless them in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.
Shout Jesus.